Justice Katju has a very long and distinguished career. He comes from a kind of distinguished vanshavali of lawyers and justices and freedom fighters. And he has served as the Chief Justice of the High Court of Delhi and a member of the Supreme Court of India. Very, very lofty position. He's the author in his judicial career of so many very interesting progressive decisions and has taken, a very positive stand against casteism and kap panchayats and this sort of retrograde movements in the society. He's a very broad-based public intellectual, Sanskrit scholar, I understand, a wide reader and an author of several books. And owing to the delays, I won't keep you very long. Mr. Justice Katju, like I would say Abhinava Shukadeva, is going to give us his own Bhavishya Purana, the very interesting, fascinating discussion of the future of India. So I'll turn the floor over to the Justice. Ask him to speak.
Very much, Professor Goldman and other respected professors, dear students, friends. First of all, I wish to thank Professor Goldman and others for having invited me here, because it is a great honor to be invited to Berkeley. Your university has an outstanding reputation throughout the world as a great center of higher learning. So it is a privilege for me to be invited here and to speak to you all. I'm going to speak on the future of India. Firstly, because I think some of you are from India or neighboring countries, you would like to know what is going on in the subcontinent. Secondly, because India is a country of 1.25 billion people. I think every one out of every five or six human beings is an Indian. So what happens in India is certainly relevant to the whole world. So I'm going to speak on this topic, the future of India, as I conceive it. See, India is presently going through a transitional period in its history. Transition from what to what? Transition from feudal agricultural society to a modern industrial society. At present, we are neither totally feudal nor totally modern. We are somewhere in between. A transition period is a terrible period in history. It is a very painful, very agonizing, very turbulent period in history. If you all have read the history of Europe from roughly the 16th to the 19th centuries, you will find that in that period, when Europe was going through its transition from a feudal society to a modern industrial society, which it is today, it was full of turbulence, turmoil, wars, revolutions, social churning, chaotic conditions, intellectual ferment. Initially, that ferment was in religious garb. The Reformation movement, Martin Luther, Calvin, and King Henry VIII of England. Then the Civil War in England. Thereafter, theories, the secular theories, Hobbes, Locke, Voltaire, Rousseau, Montesquieu, Adam Smith. It was a terrible period full of wars, chaotic conditions. In the 30 years' war in Germany, one third of the German population was wiped out. In 1618, the German population was 18 million. In 1648, it had gone down to 12 million. That means one third of the fight between the Protestants and Catholics, massacres, the Spanish Inquisition, massacres of the Protestants, and vice versa, and all. It was only after going through this fire that modern society emerged in Europe. India is presently going through this fire. We are going through a very painful period in our history, which I guess will last another 20 years or so. Next 20 years in India are going to be very turbulent. Because after all, what is a transition? See, a transition means the old society is being totally uprooted. It is being torn apart. The feudal society, the values of feudal society are being shattered. But a new society has not yet been created. There's total chaos going on. If you have read Shakespeare's play Macbeth, right in the beginning of that play, there's a sentence, fair is foul and foul is fair. I don't know whether you're students of literature. What was fair earlier, what was good earlier is regarded bad today. Fair is foul and foul. What was regarded bad earlier is regarded good today. This is what is happening in India. In the old feudal society, the caste system was regarded a good thing. Today, at least in the enlightened section of the Indian people, who are only, mind you, hardly 10%, 15%, 80, 85% are still very feudal in India, still a very backward country. But the enlightened section believes that caste system is a bad thing because it protects inequality among human beings. In the old system, you had no right to choose your life partner in marriage. Your parents decided whom you will get married to. And they decided to marry you within your caste, within your religion. Today, a certain section of youth, they are marrying somebody of their own choice, sometimes outside their caste and religion. And the result sometimes is that both are murdered, what is known as honor killing. In many parts of India, if a girl of one caste marries a boy of another caste, both are murdered by the relatives or the members of their caste. All this is going on because there's still a lot of feudal elements in Indian society who are very backward, who will not tolerate any changes in the customs of India. Earlier there was very few divorces in feudal times. Boys and girls were married in childhood. A boy was 14 years of age, girl was 13 or 12 years of age, they were married. They grew up together and they adjusted, so there was hardly any divorce. Today, our courts of law are flooded with cases of divorce, custody, maintenance and so on. So Indian society is having a lot of social churning which is going on today in all parts of India. Still, there is tremendous amount of casteism in Indian society. Most people who are non-scheduled caste. Scheduled caste are those who are the lowest rung of in the caste system in India. So those who are not scheduled caste, they will not normally allow their daughters to marry a scheduled caste boy. And if it does, sometimes both are murdered. This is very common. Tremendous casteism. The elections are run on caste basis, on caste and religious vote banks. There's still a lot of discrimination against women. Not in many areas, female feticide is practiced. And because of that, a law had to be made in India in 1994 by the Indian Parliament that no medical doctor can conduct a test on a pregnant woman to find out the sex of the baby inside her womb. That's a criminal offense in India. You have it in America. In America, you can find out whether your child is going to be a boy or a girl. It's a criminal offense in India because what was happening was that if it was found it's a girl, the fetus was removed because people don't want girls. In many hospitals, if a male child is born, all the relatives, they celebrate, they distribute sweets. But if a female child is born, it is regarded a big tragedy, the faces are dejected, they are very crestfallen. So there is a lot of discrimination against women, against minorities, against Muslims and Christians. Recently, many churches have been vandalized by certain rightist groups in India. So there's still a lot of backwardness in India, because of which we are still a semi-feudal society in India. What had happened was that up to 1947, India was under British rule. The British policy was firstly that make Hindus and Muslims fight with each other, divide and rule. There was a conscious policy. If you go online and read History in the Service of Imperialism, you just note it down, History in the Service of Imperialism, and read that speech given by Professor B.N. Pandey in the Indian Parliament. He's quoted the letters which used to come from London to the British authorities in India, that we must make Hindus and Muslims fight with each other so that we can control the subcontinent. That was a conscious policy of the British. And they were deliberately promoted. The British collectors used to call the Hindu Pandit in the night secretly, give him money that from tomorrow start speaking against the Muslims. And similarly, he would call the Muslim Maulvi and give him money and say, tomorrow we start speaking against the Hindus, so as to keep Hindus and Muslims fighting with each other. That poison was injected into the Indian system from 1857, when the Great Mutiny broke out. And year after year, decade after decade, the British injected that poison of hatred between the religious communities in India, Hindus and Muslims, which are the biggest communities. And that is still persisting. There's still a lot of discrimination against Muslims, because India is a Hindu majority country. Muslims find it difficult to get a house on rent. Muslims find it difficult to get jobs. There's a lot of discrimination there. Apart from that, the British policy was that India must not be allowed to become industrialized. Because if India got industrialized, it would become a big, Indian industry would become a big rival to British industry. So broadly, the British policy was that India must not be allowed to set up a heavy industrial base. They permitted only some light industries like textile industries or plantation industries, etc. But broadly, they did not allow us to set up a heavy industrial base. And they kept us agricultural, feudal, so that we don't become a rival to British industry. Now, when India got independence in 1947, and we set up a constitution in 1950, that constitution was modeled on the lines of the Western constitutions. We borrowed the parliamentary democracy, independence and judiciary from England. We borrowed the Bill of Rights and federalism from America. We borrowed the directive principles from the Irish constitution. So our Indian constitution is broadly modeled on Western lines. So it's a modern constitution, setting up a modern institutions like independent judiciary, parliament and so on, and modern principles of liberty, equality, religious freedom, etc. So the constitution was modern, with modern institution, modern principles, but the society was feudal and backward. And the whole idea was that this modern constitution will pull up Indian society from its backwardness and feudal nature and bring it into the modern world. And to some extent it did. The leaders, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, who became Prime Minister, and his colleagues, they were modern-minded people. They set up a heavy industrial base in India. And India did make some progress in industrialization. Girls started going to schools, which was not so earlier, and so on. Later on, the feudals hijacked our democracy and made it an empty shell, which it is today. Today, almost all state organs in India are hollow. Elections are run on the basis of caste and religion, which are the feudal institutions. I don't go to vote, I'll tell you frankly, because I see no point in my voting. My vote means nothing, because people in India, they vote as a vote bank of a particular caste, say the Yadav caste. 100,000 Yadavs, they will all vote for the Yadav candidate, whether he is a good man, bad man, intelligent, stupid, that's wholly irrelevant. He belongs to my caste, I will, like sheep and cattle, vote for him. Similarly, 100,000 scheduled caste vote, voting for scheduled caste candidates. So they vote as vote banks. So what does my vote matter? It means nothing. I mean, people don't vote on the merit of the candidate, whether he's a good man, bad man. They vote on the basis of caste and religion. So democracy was not meant to be run in this manner. But this is how it is being run in India. I am sorry to say our politicians in India, and I may be pardoned for using strong language, they are a bunch of crooks, rascals, who have looted India. I'm sorry to say this, but I must tell you the truth. Of all parties, I'm not naming any particular political party, I'm not naming any particular politician. They're all a bunch of rogues and rascals who are unfortunately our leaders. This is, I mean, I'm so sad to say this, but it has to be confessed. They have no genuine love for the country. They just are there for power and pelf, just to make money, just to seek power. This is the situation prevailing in India today. I have written on my blog article, Wake Up Bourbons. You can go on my blog, justicekatju.blogspot.in. And I've written an article that they are behaving like Bourbons. And you know what happened to the Bourbons in the French Revolution. This is what is going to happen to our politicians. How long is the Indian people going to tolerate such people who have been looting our country? Broadly, the situation today is that the economy has stagnated. There are massive problems. About 10 million youth are coming into the job market of India every year. But only 500,000 jobs are being created in the organized sector of the Indian economy every year. So what do the remaining 9.5 million youth do? They either become hawkers or street vendors or bouncers, stringers, criminals, beggars. The girls become prostitutes. There's massive prostitution in India, maybe 10 to 20 million girls, because of poverty. To fill their stomach, they have to sell their bodies. Massive healthcare problems. The poor people, frankly, cannot get healthcare because they can't afford it. It's so expensive. There are very good hospitals in India, some of them, but they are frightfully expensive. Only the rich and powerful people can go there. The massive healthcare problems. About 50% of our children are malnourished. And you know, if a child is not given proper nourishment, then all his life, his mind and body will not develop. He will remain retarded and stunted. 50%, these are the official figures, of our children are suffering from malnourishment. About 75% of our people of India are very poor. Educational institutions are, good educational institutions are rare, and prices have skyrocketed. Farmers are committing suicide in large numbers. If you go online and check up farmers' suicide in India, you'll see hundreds of thousands of farmers are committing suicide because farming has become uneconomical. Because the inputs are so expensive, pesticides, fertilizers, price of electricity and all have shot up, and the farmers can't get remunerative prices for their goods. So they take loans and they can't repay their loans, and their land is taken over. So many of them have committed suicide. This is the situation prevailing in India today. It is, some people say, oh, the GDP is growing up. See, you must further ask the question, who is getting the fruits of this growth? It is not enough to say that there is economic growth in India. Are the Indian people getting the fruits of that economic growth, or just a handful of big businessmen are getting the fruits of that economic growth? You have to go a little deeper. If the people are remaining poor, how does it matter if some big businessmen are becoming richer and richer? This economic theory, what should we call, the giving more concessions to the rich.
Trickle down theory.
It's a bogus theory that you keep, just give benefits to the very rich people, forget the poor people, and that will trickle down to the poor, because the, when the rich get more money, they will invest it in businesses, and that will create employment and so on. See, this, there's a fallacy in this argument, because rich people will not invest unless they get profits. And in India, the problem is that people are not investing because of lack of infrastructure, lack of proper roads, electricity, water and all. They will not invest that money in India. They will take it to some tax haven in Mauritius or some place and park it there, or invest in some other company where they can earn money. After all, businessmen are not here to do charity. See, the test of every system, whatever you may call it, is one and only one. Is the standard of living of the masses rising under that system or not? One and only one test. If only a handful of people are getting benefits, poor people are getting poorer, this is not what we want. President Franklin Roosevelt gave a speech, I don't know how many of you know about it, in January 1944. I think it's the greatest speech delivered in the 20th century by anyone in the world. It's called the Second Bill of Rights. Please note it down and see it on your YouTube and online. In January 1944, President Franklin Roosevelt said that the Bill of Rights in the US Constitution, which provides for liberty, equality, freedom of religion, and other rights, this is proved to be clearly inadequate. Because a hungry man has no use for freedom of speech or freedom of religion or liberty or equality. What use? Or an unemployed man, for that matter. He needs food, he needs a job. So this is illusory to say that you've got liberty, you are hungry, you don't have food in your stomach, but you are enjoying all the rights and the Bill of Rights. So President Franklin Roosevelt gave a speech, very powerful speech in January 1944, I think is almost forgotten today. But you can see it online, you can see it on YouTube, called the Second Bill of Rights. And he said, now we must have another Bill of Rights in the US Constitution, providing for employment to every American with a reasonable wage, providing for medical care for every American, providing for good education for every American, housing for every American. This Second Bill of Rights is necessary, otherwise the First Bill of Rights become illusory for people who are poor, who are unemployed, who are hungry. And I think that speech, it applies for the whole world and not just America. In India today, in our constitution, we have a, well, it's called the Directive Principle of State Policy, providing for economic rights to the Indian people, but that has expressly been made non-enforceable. You can't enforce those rights. So it's just an ornamentation, just a flower pot. It means nothing. So the situation in India today is that a lot of churning is taking place, a lot of ferment is taking place, an explosive situation is developing, because see, after the Industrial Revolution, which began in England in the middle of the 18th century and then spread all over the world, a unique situation has developed in world history after the Industrial Revolution. Before the Industrial Revolution, the productive forces were so weak. The farming was done by manual labor in using the bullock in India, the horse in Europe. And so little wealth was produced that only a handful of people could be rich, but the rest had to be poor. Because when the cake is so small, only a few people can eat it. After the Industrial Revolution, which began in England and then spread all over the world, now modern industry is so powerful and so big that enough wealth can be generated to give a decent life to everyone. Everybody in the world can be given a decent job, a decent income, decent health care, decent education, housing, etc. This is a unique situation which has developed in world history. So the poor people are saying, earlier we had to be poor before the Industrial Revolution. But now when we don't have to be poor, why are we being kept poor? And that is the situation in India also. In India, we have today thousands of very competent engineers, which was not the position in 1947. Because, as I said, the British policy was to keep us backward. We had very little, very few engineers in 1947, very little industry in 1947. Today, the situation has been dramatically changed. Today, we have very competent engineers. In fact, our engineers are manning your Silicon Valley here. And some of our the professors in your universities, in your science and mathematics departments, are from India, and all doing very well. So now we have got a huge pool of technical people who are very competent. We have immense natural resources. India is a huge country. It's not a small country like England or France. It's almost like a continent. So we are now potentially a big power, and we can if the correct policies come. But unfortunately, the political situation in India is so bad that the feudal forces are still very dominant, and because of that, we are still being kept very poor. But this situation cannot last long. As I said, we are passing through a transitional period, which is a period of great turbulence. Tremendous amount of turmoil is taking place in India. And ultimately, we have to create a just social order, where every Indian gets a decent life. Today, 75-80% Indians are very poor. They are not given decent life. They are not given medical care. Medical care hardly exists for the common man. Good education does not exist for the common man. Even food doesn't exist for many people. There's massive malnutrition. Women, 70% women are anemic. They don't get proper diet. You know, unless you have iron and all, you will. One third of the children of the world. This is a UNICEF report that one third of world's malnourished children live in India. This is a report of the UNICEF. And 45% children in India are underweight due to malnourishment. Many of them severely malnourished. 50% childhood deaths are due to malnourishment. They don't get enough to eat. So how long will this situation be allowed to, will be tolerated? This is not going to be tolerated very long. Things, unless the politicians remedy this situation, I am afraid there is going to be some sort of explosive situation in India, because people of India are now determined that we must have a just social order which gives a decent life to everybody, and India becomes a modern industrial power. So now I would prefer any questions you would like to ask. I've broadly told you what I want to tell you, but I would be more interested in you're asking questions, okay. Which I can answer.
All right, thank you, Justice Katju. You've painted a somewhat grim picture of India's situation today, and you were going to tell us a little bit about the future. What do you see happening now?
The future is going to be very turbulent. Mm-hmm. Next 15, 20 years are going to be very turbulent. Because, you know, transition, what is a transition? Transition means old society is being torn apart. New society has not yet been created. There's a vacuum just now. There are no values in India. You know, there were certain values in feudal society. Feudal society in India has been broken. New society has not been put in its place. With the result, there's no ethics. The children in India, they don't have any values. They just want to make money. I've spoken to young people. Young people should have idealism in them. They just want to make money by hook or crook. Because the value system is disintegrated. A new value system has not been put in its place. Next 15, 20 years are going to be very turbulent, and thereafter some kind of just social order will come. This is my prediction of the India's future. 15, 20 years are going to be terrible.
Okay.
This is the truth. You must know the truth.
Yes. Satyam Bruyat. Satyam Bruyat.
If you want me to speak lies, I can speak lies also.
No.
But I must tell you the truth. Why should I tell you lies?
Well, I see on your blog here you had made some statements, I see at the bottom, about Mr. Gandhi and Mr. Bush. So you said that the Parliament has not allowed you to give the opportunity to justify those. So maybe you could tell us what that is
you
all
see,
about.
You see, I don't know whether you've read Alice in Wonderland.
I have.
You have, okay. So, at one place there's a scene where the Queen of Hearts, she says, off with his head. Hmm. So somebody said, but what about first holding a trial and finding him guilty? She said, no, first off with his head, trial later. So the Parliament has done that to me without giving me a hearing, without giving me opportunity of defending myself. They have condemned me. They have behaved like the Queen of Hearts in Alice in Wonderland. Regarding Gandhi, see, it's all very well to create a myth, but what is the truth? When Mr. Gandhi came to India in 1915 from South Africa, right up to 1948 when he was killed for 33 years, you see his speeches, you read his articles, you can get it in the collected works of Mahatma Gandhi, maybe in your library. Yes. In almost every speech or every article, he would talk of Hindu religious ideas, of Ram Raj. You know, Lord Ram is a Hindu god, that we should go back to the age of Lord Ram. He would talk of cow protection, go raksha. He would talk of varnashram dharma, caste system. He would talk of brahmacharya, celibacy. See, if you are a saint or a sadhu in an ashram, you can say all these things. But once you enter politics in a country which has such diversity as India, there's a huge Muslim population, and there was even a greater Muslim population before partition, because that was part of United India. If you keep on propagating Hindu religious ideas, what effect is it going to have in the mind of a conservative Muslim? Will it not drive him towards an organization like the Muslim League? And therefore, are you not serving the British interests of divide and rule? Are you not objectively functioning as a British agent? Doing the work of, objectively I am saying, of dividing the people on religious lines. And secondly, there was a revolutionary movement developing in India under Bhagat Singh and Chandrasekhar Azad and Anushilan Party, Surya Sen and all that. Gandhi's, the British were very scared of that movement against British rule. Just like your American Revolution, was it non-violent? Was George Washington leading an army or taking flowers to present to the British? Revolution means a violent, something violent. Otherwise, you know, do you think the British would have given up their huge empire just because of Gandhi's fasting, going on fast for 2 weeks, not eating for 2 weeks, or going on a salt march? No, because it was the Germany attacked Britain in the Second World War and considerably weakened England. In fact, probably Germany would have conquered England had America not come to England's help at that time. So England was considerably weakened, and because of American pressure, for these reasons the British had to withdraw from India, not because of Gandhi. In fact, had it been for Gandhi, British would have remained there, because he diverted the revolutionary struggle in India led by the real revolutionaries like Bhagat Singh, Chandrasekhar Azad, Surya Sen, the Anushilan Party, Khudiram Bose, who sacrificed their lives. They were all hanged. And he diverted that revolutionary movement towards harmless and nonsensical channels like Satyagraha and all that, that you keep beating your chest and British will leave you. Do you think anybody gives up an empire like that? Did the British give up their empire in England by offering them sweets or offering them flowers? No, you had to fight for it. So similarly, it was a big drama, and he is called the father of the nation. The real revolutionaries are all relegated in our history books to the footnotes. Nobody remembers them. They are treated as mavericks, as deviants, outside the stream of the freedom struggle. And the real great man is this man Gandhi, who in my opinion a big fraud. All right, you are entitled to your opinion. I regard him as just a fraud and objectively a British agent.
Mr. Bose?
Bose had become a Japanese agent. See, just consider, see, the Japanese were invading India, and they used Bose as a tool. If he was not an agent, when the Japanese surrendered in 1945, why did Bose also give up the struggle? He should have carried on a guerrilla war. That means there was nothing in him except unless he gets support from the Japanese, there was nothing. The moment Japanese surrendered, you also give. So the Japanese were using him, and the moment his utility was over, the Japanese would have bumped him off. They would have eliminated him. Had the Japanese conquered India, do you think they would have given independence to India? No, they would have looted India, exploited India the way they did to China. Parts of China which the Japanese occupied, Manchuria and other places, they had looted it. They would have looted India. So Bose was just being used by the Japanese. See, I have said and I have been attacked by people in saying that 90% Indians are fools. But I believe it. The truth has to be said, because when you are... should I call you an intelligent man although you are a fool? I'll call you what you are. The fact is the Indians are, you know, most of them, not all, is full of casteism, full of superstitions. They believe in astrology. 90%, 95% people believe that you will, your future will be decided by movement of stars and planets. When I went to take over as Chief Justice of Madras High Court, I got a telephone call from the Registrar General of Madras. My Lord, please don't take oath during Rahu Kalam time. I said, what is this? This is the inauspicious hour according to astrology. Don't take. And this is what happens even when ministers, prime ministers, chief justices take oath, they first consult an astrologer to find out what is the auspicious time. There's tremendous backwardness in it, because astrology is all nonsense. It is humbug, unscientific superstition. But 95% people believe in it. So we have to have India has to have a long road ahead to remove the backwardness and make the masses of India part of the enlightened section of Indian people. That's a massive struggle. Changing the minds of people is much more difficult than changing physical things. Changing the mindset, people who are steeped in backwardness. Today I received an email from a young girl of 26. She belongs to the Dalit, you know, scheduled caste, the depressed class. She asked my advice. She says she's studying in Master's in Technology in some Delhi University. And she says, for 9 years I've been having a relationship with an upper caste boy. But the boy's parents are totally against me. They will not touch any glass which I have touched, because you are an untouchable. What am I to do? Of course, I told her that, look, you better tell the young man that now make up your mind, either you choose me or choose your parents, because for 9 years you've been going around with him. Now he has to decide. He can't keep you hanging like this forever. So any other questions, anybody?
Let's open the floor to questions.
Do you see any silver lining at all for India?
Yes, good
I question. Told you silver lining is that for next 15-20 years are going to be very turbulent, and patriotic people are required in India, but they have to make great sacrifices, like the Americans made sacrifices during their war or war of independence. See, if next 15-20 years are going to be terrible. Please don't expect things to improve in the next 15-20 years. They are going to get worse. There is going to be tremendous turmoil in India. Almost civil war conditions will arise. Because just imagine, how long will people tolerate this nonsense? The politicians are looting our country. People are so poor, people can't get medical care, can't get education, can't get food. How long will people tolerate this nonsense? Yes, please.
Pramod and then you.
Okay, I had two questions. One was, how did you come up with this number, 15 to 20 years?
Roughly,
40 years?
No, it's a rough guess. I'm not saying it's a mathematical figure. It's a rough guess. What I mean to say is, not going to take 1 year or 2 years. It will take a long time, long struggle. Because the vested interests in the feudal order are still very powerful, and they will not let changes take place very easily. The powerful vested interests which want to keep India backward.
And my second question was that, although you said that people are preferentially voting to the leaders who are of their same caste or whatever, But it seems the present election result was swayed to those who kind of said that development is our agenda.
See, what had happened in the parliament election of May 2014, the contest was between Mr. BJP led by Mr. Modi on the one hand and the Congress on the other hand. The Congress party was so discredited because they had looted India. Every second week there was another scam, not millions but billions of dollars being taken away from India and put in some foreign banks. Looting was going on by the Congress party, so people were disgusted with this. And on the other hand, Mr. Modi came up with the slogan of development. Now, the young people voted en masse solidly for Mr. Modi because, you know, the voting age in India has been reduced from 21 to 18. I spoke to a lot of young people in India from various parts of India. They would meet me, universities, colleges. They were solid Modi supporters because they thought development means thousands and thousands of industries will be created. Millions of jobs will be created. Young men are interested in jobs. Their one-point program is give us jobs. So they solidly voted for Modi and he got the majority. That was in May 2014. But the jobs are not there. You see, jobs can't be created by your shouting and screaming. Jobs are created when the economy is rapidly expanding. Economy is stagnant. So people have become totally disillusioned with the BJP. They said, we voted for you because you said you'll give us jobs, but there are no jobs. So in the Delhi elections, you may have seen, which took place in February 2015, they went for Aam Aadmi Party, another party, and which was a negative vote for Mr. solid negative vote for Mr. Modi, which means within 9 months, that huge euphoria has vanished, euphoria in favor of Mr. Modi has vanished, and people are very disillusioned with him. They wanted an alternative, they voted for the Aam Aadmi. But this Aam Aadmi Party is also a party of jokers. There's nothing left. You see, what does their leader Mr. Kejriwal say? If you read his book called Swaraj, he's written a book. He says, to solve India's problems, we should devolve power to the village communities, village panchayats and gram. Now, if you have any idea of how these village panchayats function, they are centers of corruption, casteism, backward people, petty people. So it is nonsense to say that you can solve India's problem by devolving power. This is what Gandhi also used to say, devolve power to village self-communities. These village self-communities are centers of reaction, of casteism, of corruption. They were the presidents of these panchayats have grabbed all the land. There was certain land which was meant for the common use of the villagers. It's all been illegally grabbed by these powerful landholders. So it is all nonsense to say that you hand over power to the village communities and your problem will be solved. So people have been disillusioned with Aam Aadmi Party also. They came to power just recently and within 3 weeks or 1 month, people have become disillusioned.
You had a question.
During Europe's transition into industrialization, they had no prior example.
They did not have
a prior example of what an industrialized country would look like. Whereas for India, they have a prior example. Shouldn't that ease some of the tensions and turmoil since they know?
I did not follow your question. What did you mean? What exactly are you trying to say?
India has an example of what India.
All right. Yes, that's right.
Whereas Europe didn't. So shouldn't India have less turmoil?
Listen, the turmoil will take place because the feudal elements are still very powerful in India and they don't want changes. You see, they will resist changes very fiercely. So, because of that, there will be a lot of clashes. It will not be very peaceful. Yes, please.
In the back there. You, go.
Okay. During presidential election, if you go and talk to a person in the street in the United States of America and ask him which candidate stands for what and what's going on, they don't know anything. So if that's the situation in America, what do you expect in India?
I would not like to comment about America. I am only commenting about India. See, please don't compare India with America. America is an industrialized country. Here the transition is over. In fact, USA never had a feudal society. There were feudal societies in Europe. What happened was that the Europeans migrated to this North America, bringing with them their technical skills in a land of huge, immense resources, and there was a growth of industry. So, but in Europe there were feudal societies, and in feudal societies there was tremendous turmoil. Regarding America, I am not making comments, I am commenting about India.
Jaini.
The one option which you have not touched so far, and which is alive in India, in parts of India, but hidden from the public, the Maoist movement with guns and a parallel government being run from Hyderabad, once upon a time Telugu speaking area, then Orissa, then coming into Calcutta, Bengal, going into Nepal, what happened in Nepal. Something like that, a sort of a cultural revolution also, as it happened in China, which destroyed all the educated people to suits. Educational people, educated people.
Frankly, I have no idea about that movement.
Yeah, but that
I can't comment.
That is an option which is going to develop. Otherwise, there
I can't
be violence.
Comment on that. I have no idea about that.
Is that an option available to the rest of India?
I don't know because I have not studied that. I can't comment.
Okay, Vish.
So a question about secularism. A lot of what you said seems to imply that, you know, religion is a source for a lot of these tensions,
yes.
Right? And the Indian constitution has a very sort of interesting kind of secularism which is divergent from the Western secularism of government will have nothing to do with religion as opposed to government will support all religion. Do you think that was a mistake, and do you think we need a shift to a secularism which...
Secularism means that religion is your private affair. It is unconnected with the state, which will have no religion. It simply means it. Secularism does not mean that you cannot practice your religion, but it's your private affair. The government will have nothing to do. There's separation between church and state. So that is the same in India as in America. We have a secular constitution, and because of that, we have done better than Pakistan, which is a theocratic. Pakistan is in a territory. Yes, please.
Well, if India has what one would describe as a pseudo-democracy, in that people are voting based on either religious preferences and so on, many times the alternative to that is an authoritarian regime. In other words, one group gains control of the government, more like the Chinese model, and then you have control, you know, from the top down. What's the possibility of that happening
in
India?
At present, I don't see any possibility. But it is true that the politics in India has, it has been hijacked by the feudal elements, these caste elements, religious elements. In fact, about one third of the members of the Indian Parliament they have criminal records. They're criminals. And they are sitting in Parliament. These are official figures. Because people vote for them because of their caste or religion. They don't care whether he's a good man, bad man, criminal, educated man, all that is irrelevant. If he's of my caste or religion, they vote like sheep and cattle, they vote. So that is why these, as I said, our institutions have become hollow.
Justice, on the one hand, you lament the high rate of suicide of the farmers and so on,
yes,
right? I mean,
yes.
that's very true. But on the other hand, you propagate, you profess industrialization and so forth. One of these industrialization, modern industrial societies don't do well is agriculture. In fact, they destroyed agriculture. America is really not any longer an agricultural society. Europe even much less. They import or they use a lot of fertilizers, GMO, which is why GMO now thrives, the genetically, and food is bad. Food is really actually unhealthy. So if you destroy agriculture base, which you think was one of the problems of so-called feudal society as you describe this, then what do you have in place? from 50% of malnutrition of children, you'll go to 70% of malnutrition. Where is India going to get its food to feed so many people? China did something different. It maintained its feudal, so-called, not so much the feudal structure, but maintained its agricultural base. India is destroying it, and it's letting Monsanto and companies like that come and wholesale destroy it. What is going on in this area?
You are right. This is a big problem in India. Farmers are facing a terrible crisis. I have spoken to many farmers. They say our farming is no longer economic because the inputs are so costly, so expensive that we hardly get any returns. It's a massive problem in India. And so far as industrialization is concerned, see, the question is not that whether you are getting industrialized. The question is, second question is, who is getting the fruits of that industrialization? Is it just a handful of big businessmen, or is it the masses? The fruits of industrialization is a good thing, but the fruit should go to the masses, not just a handful of people who are becoming richer and richer. Rich are becoming richer, poorer are becoming poorer. That is not the correct way. That is going to create an explosion one day. It's bound to lead to an explosion. You have to, a system, as I said, the test of every system is just one and only test. Is it raising the standard of living of the masses or not? That's all, nothing else needs to be asked. Yes, please.
In the back, yeah.
Yeah, so I'm a little confused about your views. It seems like you're suggesting a shift from agriculture to industry. From the other hand, you're saying that in this industry should not be in the hands of a select few people. So I want to know more about that. And secondly, what are your views on the land acquisition bill passed by the UP in 2030 and the one new amendment bill brought by the NDA government right now?
You see, these land acquisition bills, both the earlier government, this government, are anti-farmer, and I personally am opposed to them because the farmers produce the food which we eat in India. This is only, see, the economic policy of the present government in India is to benefit the big businessmen, and not the entire big business class, but just a certain particular big business people.
But if you don't acquire land from farmers, how do you propose we go about industrialization?
See, there's a way to do it. But if you see what actually happens in theory is very different from what happens in practice. In theory, they are to be given compensation and all that. But in reality, their land is taken away. But for a long time, they are not given any money. They have to run around. They have to give bribes to people to get their compensation. This is the actual situation. The problem in India is that there are very good laws, but they are not implemented. In America, you have laws, but they are implemented, they are followed. You have anti-pollution laws in America, people observe them. There are housing laws in India, people observe. In India, there are laws, but nobody follows them. You give a bribe to some official and then you ignore that law. Yes, please.
Some people argue that corruption is probably the biggest problem India is facing at this point in time.
Yes.
Do you agree? And if so, what do you propose as a sort of solution to that problem?
Corruption is a big problem, but corruption will last as long as this transition period will last, 15, 20 years. I've written an article on it. You need go on my blog, India in Transition and Corrupt. Please go on my blog and read it. And I've given my reasons. It's all very well to talk against corruption. Anybody who seriously tries to suppress corruption is going to be eliminated. As happened to one officer, Mr. D.K. Ravi, you may have read in the... If you seriously try to stop the mafia in India, the building mafia and all, you are inviting trouble for yourself and you will be bumped off. This is the reality. So you should only play lip service of fighting corruption. Just talk about it, don't really do it. Otherwise, you are a fool and you are inviting trouble for yourself.
Shrit, yeah, you have been a judge for a long time. My grandfather was also a judge. So I'm sure that you at some points have been offered bribe or something like that. What have you done?
Well, in fact, I used to say in open court that a lot of lawyers and litigants, I used to say that you people never even offer me bribe. At least tempt me. Maybe I may succumb to the temptation. But you treat me as such a hopeless case. Nobody comes to offer me a bribe even. You should at least make the experiment. See, I had the reputation of being a bit of a, well, a maverick or whatever you may call me. This chap is not to be messed around with. Don't try to be funny with him. So nobody offered me a bribe when I used to appeal to them. But yes, there's massive corruption. It has gone up to very high levels in India, in the judiciary. I don't say all judges are corrupt. There are many upright judges also. But a large section of the higher judiciary in India have become corrupt. When I started law practice in 1971, January, in Allahabad High Court, that's my parent High Court, there was no corrupt judge in the High Court. There were judges who were pleasant, judges who were unpleasant, judges who were courteous, judges who were nasty and so on, but no corrupt judge. And maybe in no High Court in India was there a corrupt judge. Corruption had come into the lower judiciary, but not into the higher judiciary. Today, my guess is something like 50% of the higher judiciary in India has become corrupt. I know it because I was deep into the system. I was Chief Justice of 3 High Courts. I was Judge of the Supreme Court. My guess is roughly 50% of judges in the higher level have become corrupt. I can name many Chief Justices of India who were corrupt. It's an open fact. So, after all, where do judges come from? They are not angels who fall from the sky. They are part of society. When corruption has spread in society, it's bound to spread among judges also.
You have a question, yes?
Yeah, I was wondering, you spoke about a better 10% of the society. And
about?
A better 10%, like you said, 90% were stuck.
90% are fools. I've called them fools.
Yeah, about 90% were stuck in the feudal society.
Yes.
I was wondering how the better 10% could act as a catalyst and help the remaining 90% come away from the type of society, feudal society that you talk about.
If you are among the 10%, you will only take up a job in a big company and enjoy life. But if you have patriotism in you, as the American revolutionaries, George Washington and all, they had patriotism. They were very rich people. George Washington was a very rich farmer. Thomas Jefferson was a very rich farmer. They sacrificed, they took a risk. They said, we have to fight for our country. So if you have that patriotic spirit, like George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, and so on, then you will do something to help your country and bring up the level of the people, which at present is at a very low intellectual level. Indians, 80-90% are very backward. The tremendous feudalism and backwardness and stupidity among the Indian people. I'm sorry to say I'm myself an Indian, but the truth has to be said. People, they say, oh, you have defamed India. And I say, what is the meaning of defaming India? Should I not speak the truth? In fact, when I was going to come here to speak to you, I put up a post on my Facebook page. So people said, don't denigrate India. Don't denounce India. I said, look, I'm going to speak the truth. Whether it denigrates or uplifts, I'm not concerned. The truth is the truth. 2 + 2 = 4. Whether it makes you happy or makes you unhappy, it doesn't matter. So this is the truth. Yes, please.
In the back, the lady in the back, please. Yeah.
Okay. I have a couple of questions on Gandhi.
One yes. by one, please, one by one, otherwise I'll get mixed up. But can I have some more water?
Water is right there on
the
couch.
This
what?
One?
Yeah.
You need more water.
Please. Yes, please. But please, one by one.
Right.
You ask one question, hear the answer, then ask the second question, and so on.
Okay.
Otherwise, if you ask 10 questions at the same time, I'll forget.
Okay. The first question is, Gandhi, being a Hindu, his idea of good governance, his knowledge of good governance or example of good governance was Ram Rajya. He did not have an Islamic example of good governance or something. All that he knew about good governance was Ram Rajya. Not because Ram was Hindu, but that is his knowledge or what he has been fed on. And he also spoke Allah Theronam and Ishwar Theronam and all that. He never said, you must pray only to Hindu God. So, why do you say he was promoting Hinduism and dividing and all this?
See, if you read his speeches and articles in the collected works of Mahatma Gandhi, you'll get in the library. you will find constantly he is advocating Hindu religious ideas like Ram Raj, like Gorakshak, cow protection. He said, I will spread cow protection throughout the world. And Varnashram Dham, caste system. He said, I quoted in my blog his speeches that I am a Sanatani Hindu, I believe in the caste system, I believe in the protection of the cow, I want Ram Raj. See, if you keep on saying this, whatever you may mean yourself, you may, whatever is in your own mind, but what effect is it going to have on the conservative Muslim mind? Mind you, in undivided India, the Muslims were, the percentage of Muslim was much more than it is today because part of it has gone into Pakistan. If you keep on injecting religion into politics, whatever may be your motive, I'm asking objectively what result is it going to, what effect is it going to have in a conservative Muslim mind? Will he not be driven towards a communal organization like the Muslim League? So are you not objectively acting as a British agent? Forget about what you are subjectively. What you are saying is subjectively. I'm talking objectively. Is the effect not going to be that you are dividing Indian society on religious lines, which is the British policy? Second question, please.
My second question, very simple one. Subhash Chandra Bose and Gandhi, Japanese agent and British agent, do you attribute any patriotism at all to them?
They are anti-national. What? How can they be patriotic? A person who is damaging the country by dividing Hindus and Muslims, by dividing the people, he's an anti-national. Gandhi was an anti-national, and Subhash Chandra Bose by becoming an agent of the Japanese fascists. See, Japanese were terrible people in the Second World War, mind you. I'm not talking of Japanese today. In the Second World War, what they did in Shanghai, what they did in Nanking massacres and horrible things they did, he had become an agent of those terrible people. So how can they be patriots? I don't regard them as patriots. Yes.
Is the judiciary independent of executive in India?
In theory, yes. In practice, no.
Okay. Does it attribute to the degradation of the judicial standards in India?
Yes, of course.
And that
the fact is that
even the enlightened 10% is capable of being tainted, given an opportunity, right?
Sorry, I didn't.
If I'm given an opportunity to be correct and get away with it, I will continue to do that. Isn't that a sad commentary on human nature?
It depends if your parents have instilled good values in you in your childhood. If your parents have instilled good values in you in childhood and taught you that you must not do wrong things, then the probability is that when you grow up, you will not be corrupt. But if your parents themselves are corrupt, as it is very common in India today, when the child sees his parent doing corruption, will he not become corrupt?
So all the enlightened education does not help at all?
They are two different things. You may be very intelligent, but you may be an evil man. You may be a corrupt man. You see, that depends on what values have been instilled in your mind in childhood by your parents. Have they given you good values? If they have not, if they are themselves crooks, what can be expected? And unfortunately, a large section of the adults in India are crooks.
Well, let's take one or two more questions and then give the rest to our speaker. You can meet with him. We have a question here and one more there.
I have two questions. First is, I understand your cynicism and you have your own opinion, which is welcome. But what do you think about the civil disobedience movement, which helped India so much because Mahatma Gandhi had such a wide reach and civil disobedience was essentially not falling with the British? No, the business could not be percolated.
It is all empty gas. I'm telling you the real freedom struggle against the British were the revolutionary struggles by Bhagat Singh, Chandrasekhar Azad, the armed struggle, this Anushilan Samiti, Surya Sen and all that. The British became very scared of this revolutionary struggle which was growing in India. So they brought in Gandhi so as to divert attention from the revolutionary direction in which the freedom struggle was taking towards a harmless channel, a nonsensical channel, satyagraha, civil disobedience and all that, which means nothing. You know, do you think the British will give up India because Gandhi goes on fast or he holds a march? Do you think empires are given up this way? It was not because of Gandhi that India got independence. It was because of Adolf Hitler. Which, of course, he didn't want that, but indirectly, that was what caused the British to leave, because when the Germans attacked England, and they considerably weakened England, and probably they would have conquered England but for American help, and because of American pressure on the British, that is why the British left India. Not because of your civil disobedience movement and your going and singing and dancing. You think anybody gives up an empire like that? You think the British gave up the United States just because George Washington gave them flowers or lollipops? No, the Americans had to fight with arms against the British.
We have one follow-up question there, then we'll...
And also, I understand you criticize Indian values and systems, but don't you think our family values and a lot of values are stronger than the Western culture? We respect, we stay together and all those things. Aren't they better than the Western cultures?
And you have also a lot of rubbish in your culture also. It is all Indian culture, not part of it is good. I was giving an example of an email I got today from a 26-year-old girl belonging to the Dalit class, the depressed class. She is studying in Master of Technology in Delhi. And she's saying that the boy with whom I have a relation for 9 years, he is of an upper caste, and the parents of that boy say, nothing doing, you will never marry this girl, because he won't even touch the glass which she touches. She is untouchable. They said, this is also a value of Indian culture. So there is a lot of rubbish in Indian culture also. Don't blindly follow everything. There are good things and bad things.
Last question here.
Yeah, I have two earlier questions. One is, what do you think about the NDA government's proposed National Judicial Appointments Commission? And secondly, what do you think about Gandhi?
One by one, please. You ask one question, stick to it, then you come. I'll answer that. See, you may have any system of appointment of judges. There's the present system where the judges choose the judges, or the new proposed system in India, there's a commission to select judges. See, every system really depends on the human personnel who are manning that system or institution. Unless they are first-class people, unless the members of that commission are first-class people, it will again become an empty shell. See, you may have a lovely Supreme Court, but if the judges sitting inside are taking bribes, it has become a hollow institution. So, every institution, every system will depend on who are the people who are manning that system or institution. So, we will have to wait and see who are the people appointed there. Unless they are first-class people, again they will select useless people as judges, undeserving people as judges. Yes, please.
What was your other question?
And what do you think about Gandhi and the Khilafat movement where he...
Gandhi?
And the Khilafat movement.
Just imagine, in Turkey, the modern leader, Kemal Mustafa Atatürk, wanted to modernize Turkey because it had become the sick man of Europe. And he removed the Khalifa, the backward, feudal-minded person. Now Gandhi wants him to be reinstated. What nonsense? Gandhi wants the Khalifa to be reinstated so that Turkey again becomes backward. Just consider it. Have you read the history of Turkey, modern Turkey? Kemal Atatürk, he said, nothing doing. We have, because of this feudal institution, we have suffered so much. We are going to modernize Turkey. And Gandhi says, no, the Khalifa must be restored. What nonsense. Gandhi was a feudal-minded person, I mean, totally backward, third-rate man.
One name we have not heard pass your lips today was Pandit Nehru. What is your opinion on him?
Pandit Nehru is the only politician in India I respect. He has his defects. True, he had defects, but compared to others, he was a modern-minded person. He laid the foundation of heavy industry in India. He set up engineering colleges. IIT, I think many of you are graduates from Indian Institutes of Technology in India. It's his gift. He was a man, he had been educated in England, man with a modern vision. He is the only politician in India I respect. I don't respect his daughter, Indira Gandhi, who was a power-crazy crook. She was only interested in hanging on to power. She imposed an emergency, put hundreds of thousands of people in jail. And the less said about the Sonia Gandhi, the better. Or of Rahul Gandhi.
Let's thank our visitor for a very stimulating talk. Up to the highest ideal of the ancient literature, Satyam Brayat Natupriyam. Only speak the truth, not what people want to hear. So please join us now for an informal gathering, and you can get to chat with the justice, I think, informally. Thank you.